So this talks about comparing two different approaches for termination analysis. And so these are two very popular approaches. So they have been implemented in various tools. And so one is the size change abstraction, and the other ones are transition invariants. And so authors of both papers are present in the audience, so I'm happy to report on these results. So the, as you can see, the size change abstraction was proposed first, and then a couple of years later, transition invariants have been proposed. And in the paper on transition invariants, you can read that the authors say that termination analysis in size change abstraction has been a motivation for doing this work. And so in this talk, I want to relate these two approaches and shed some light on their relationship. And so previously, some results have been known, but so I will present a tighter relation in this talk. So I will take some time to introduce both approaches, and then I can formulate the question and the result. So here I present a code snippet which I will use as a running example. So I want to shortly go over it. So on the left you can see a program. So where we have two variables x and y, they're both initialized to n, and then we are repeating this loop as long as the variable x is greater than zero. And in the loop body, so we check if the variable is y is greater than zero. If this is the case, we decrement it. If not, we decrement y, and then we reset y to n. So this gives you basically a quadratic iteration pattern. And the idea of the size change abstraction is that so we're going to abstract this program. So in this talk, I will not focus on how we actually do the abstraction, so I will just appeal to your intuition. And so on the right, so you can see this program which has two transitions, and so they correspond to the if branch of the loop and the else branch of the loop. And so the information you want to keep is that in one branch, you know that the variable x decreases. So we have the variable x prime for denoting the next state. So this is a transitional abstraction. And so we forget about what's happening to y, but this means y can take any value. And in the other branch of the loop, so we see that the variable y decreases and x at least does not increase. And so now you can view this abstraction again as a program. It's describing an abstract program, but nevertheless, so it defines a transition system and so on. And so I can view it as a program. So to relate it to the first talk of today, so the interesting thing about these kinds of programs is that they are so restricted that you can actually compute their transitive closure precisely. So in the size change abstraction, you're really restricting yourself to these kinds of predicates. So you can view it as a limited predicate abstraction, or you can view it as an abstract domain where you're saying the only things I remember are inequalities of this shape, so greater and greater equal. And you can only have one variable on each side of this equation. So you can have terms, but this is like part of the abstraction. So like when we're talking just about the so conceptual point of view, and for simplification, I'm limiting myself here to variables. But so in previous work, we have published on this, so I can talk to you afterwards. So now, when you view this as an abstract program, so the first thing, it's also interesting what is the domain of these variables, and you can get like a trivial answer from the type. Like for this kind of program, it makes sense to assign the natural numbers to the variables. But you can do like a pre-analysis, for example, by the octagon domain, and you can discover that your variables actually will always take values between 0 and this number n. So we can fix this domain 0, n for this program. And so the size change abstraction has been of interest because termination is decidable. And so termination is decidable. So you can, using automata theoretic techniques, so you can view this kind of this program as an automaton, and so I don't want to go over the details, but the idea is that you view it as a Büchi automaton, so you have these accepting and non-accepting transitions, and accepting transitions, they track off, make sure that you see infinitely many greater. So this automata theoretic view has been very productive for analyzing this abstraction, and so in a previous result, so we were able to show that you can not only decide termination for this abstraction, but you can also decide the asymptotic complexity of programs. And so when you interpret an abstraction over domain n, so from 0 to n, then you can compute precisely for a given size change program that its asymptotic complexity. And so you can see here, so we have theta n to the k, and so 1k, so you can compute the k according to the program you're analyzing. And it really can be a rational number, so you can get complexities like n times square root of n. And so we have been able to obtain this result, like by extending this automata view, so viewing this automaton then as a max plus automaton and analyzing their asymptotic behavior. And so for this example, so you will actually get that this abstract program has the complexity n square. So now, on the other hand, so we have transition invariance, and so I will introduce them here quickly as well. So, so this is like the most abstract formulation, and so you just simply view your program as a transition relation, and then, so in order to show termination, we are going to help ourselves with some set of well-founded relations, T1 to the TK, and each of these relations is well-founded. And then an assumption is that the transitive file of the program is contained in the union of these relations. And so this is, so you can summarize these assumptions by just saying the union of these transitions is a transition invariant for the program, and then the statement about termination is that when these assumptions are true, then the program itself is well-founded, so aka terminating. And so I will also give a proof, a glimpse into the proof, because so it's short, so you can actually present it, and because I'm going to compare it and use this ideas from this proof. So the proof goes as follows. So assume we have an execution of the program, so we have a sequence of steps, and each of the steps are in the transition relation. So then the assumption is saying, so we have these relations, T1 to the TK, and every pair of states in this execution is in this is in one of the relations. And then we are invoking the infinite Ramsey theorem, and then we are getting that, so we can pick like a subsequence of the states, and they have this nice property that they will always be in one of these relations. And this would give an infinite descent in one of the relations, which is a contradiction to this assumption. So this relation Ti is like a witness why this cannot be. And so this is what we want to use this idea later on as well. So let's now come back to our example. Now I'm giving a different analysis, so now the same program, but now we are using transition invariance. So we are having this program, and we are modeling it by these relations row 1 and row 2. So again, these relations row 1 and row 2 will correspond to one branch through the loop, but so they are precise, like I'm really modeling the semantics of the program by these relations. And then we are using T1 and T2, so as in the previous statement, so they are going to be the transition invariants. And so I'm claiming that the transitive file of the program gamma is contained in the union of these two relations. So how do you prove something about the transitive file? So clearly you normally use induction. So So in order to convince you that this is really a transitive, that this contains the transitive file of the program, I would conduct this kind of proof. So you can see in the first two lines we have the induction start. So I say that each relation itself is contained in these two relations, and then I say, okay, when I take one more step of the program, am I again landing in one of these relations? So by induction, so you are contained in the transitive file. The transitive file is contained in these relations. I am in this talk, for convenience, not really distinguishing between the relation and the representation of the relation by predicates. So I'm appealing to your intuition. But I just want to mention here that, like, this kind of proof, when you use it, when you really do it by predicates, then you can do it using this set of predicates. And then using the set of predicates, you can obtain the proof I've just shown you. And I want to stress that this is an inductive proof. So we have used this kind of reasoning to reason about the transitive hull and of a program, and I will come back to this. So my interest has been in conducting complexity analysis, and there has been previous work on doing complexity analysis with transition invariants. So there has been this very nice result by Blas and Gurevich, which relates the transition invariant and the program. And so here, these two bars, they denote the height of a relation, so the ordinate height of a relation. And so then we have this statement, which relates the ordinate height of the relation by using a suitable notion of multiplication. And so for this talk, so I will just talk about this a simple instantiation. So we assume that all the height of all these relations, t1 to the k, is a natural number n, so it's some finite number. And you have that the height of the program is bounded by a polynomial where the exponent is the number of relations. And so you can think of the height of a relation in this special case as the length of the longest sequence in this relation. So what does this mean? So for our example, so here I have told you that here we have a transition invariant, which consists of these two relations, T1 and T2. And then, again, by using this fact that the variables x and y, they take values from 0 to n, and you can prove this, for example, by octagon, you can then deduce, using this previous result, that the complexity of this program is n square. So because we have a transition invariant of two relations, the complexity is n square. And this is nice, this reasoning, but it could be more precise. And here is an example of the same program where I've deleted the reset of y to n from the else branch of this loop, and then we don't have a reset anymore. And so this program actually has complexity, a linear complexity. But we cannot get this from just using the previous presented result, because we have a transition invariant which has two relations, so the only complexity we can deduce is n square. Nevertheless, so the question is, just using the facts we have proven, can we still get the complexity O of n? So now I've managed to introduce all the parts of the title of the paper, and so I can finally present the statement. So we have, on the one hand, the Seichtian subtraction. On the left, so we have a transition invariance, but with this inductive argument. So this is important. And so I want to relate these two abstractions. And the goal is first understanding the relationship on itself, But the other goals are that we can transfer these results from the right to the left. So because for the sidechain abstraction, the results I've presented you, so we have a precise complexity analysis, and I've motivated the problem that so we would have to have, we would like to have something similar for transition invariance, and the same you could have about termination, and I will present an example later. So the main idea of the talk, and so the main insight behind this paper, is that so when you have an inductive termination proof, so that you have that this proof has an automaton structure. So this automaton structure has been noticed previously, but it has not been exploited. And so in this talk, I'm using this automaton structure to get much more information out of this proof. And so how does this automaton look like? So this is on the right is the what we've reasoned about before. And I'm just using the bottom part as a transition table for my automaton. So I'm just drawing this automaton on the left. So where we have been for the first line, we have an initial state going to the respective relation t. And then when we do one more step, then we end up in certain transition relations. And so this is the proof structure which underlies this proof. And now what is the effect of this observation that that we want to use? Is that so before, so I've shown you this picture as part of the proof of Ramsey's theorem. And now an insight is that when you take certain steps in the program, we know more. So here, between the first and the second step, we're using relations row one and row two, and in the fourth and fifth as well. And so we know that they must be labeled by the same relation. So this picture is in fact wrong. So or it cannot happen, so that I should say. Always it has to be like this. So because when you have an automaton, it determines like in which relation you are. And this is the main reason why you don't need Ramsey's theorem, and you can get by purely by automata theoretic techniques when you want to show proof termination. And so we will follow this insight. And so I need to be define precisely the object I'm talking about. And the idea is that so we really separate the proof structure from the relations we are talking about. So I have presented this automaton, and now I'm like making a distinction between the automaton, and I'm introducing like states and an alphabet, and I'm interpreting, and I need to have an interpretation of these relations and states, of these letters and states by a relation. So it's the same as before, so when just from going from here to here, so you see that, so now I'm having these two functions, rho and lambda, which associate a relation to the letters and to the states. And so if I have such functions and they satisfy these equations, so I call such a lambda an inductive function. And so now I'm taking a new view on transition predicate abstraction, but I want to eliminate the predicate part of it. So I'm really defining it abstractly on relation. So I say, like an automaton is a transition abstraction of a program, if I can find such an assignment of the letters and the states to relations, such that the relations, they cover my program. So on the right, you see that I wanted the relations of the letters, they represent the transition relation of my program. And so I want that this labeling of the states is inductive. So this is you have seen, so just before the motivation. And now an interesting insight for using the automata theoretic view is that, so we say that the well-founded relations are the final states of the automaton. So all the final states of the automaton must be labeled by well-founded relations. And so this comes from that we want to basically do the same reasoning as in transition invariants. So we're using well-founded relations, and so it ends up that the final states need to be labeled by well-founded relations. And then, so when you have done this definition, so which is the central definition of this talk, then I can reformulate the termination criterion of Rybachenko and Podelsky in this transition invariant paper. So it needs a little massaging, but then you end up with this statement. So that if the automaton is a universal and it's a transition abstraction of a program gamma, then this program gamma terminates. And so this now you can ask, is this the most precise termination criterion for your given the information you have computed? So when you have fixed the automaton, then and it's abstracting your program, so is this the most precise you can do? And the answer is no. And I will see a distinguishing example. We will see a distinguishing example shortly. And so instead of using this criterion, so I am suggesting a second criterion, and the criterion goes like this. So it's also using an automaton, and the idea is that instead of using this automaton A, which we have on the left-hand side, we are using this automaton on the right-hand side. And so the automaton on the right-hand side, so it looks complicated, but it's constructed very simply. So on the top and on the bottom, you can see a copy of the original automaton. And so we've just added an initial state where you can trade, where you can wait arbitrarily long, and then you move to one of the copies. And it's a Bücher automaton, so the on the left is a finite word automaton, and on the right we have a Bücher automaton, so there are different kinds of automata. And so what is this automaton doing? So we are seeing this epsilon transition, and construction idea of this automaton is very simple. So what we have seen in Büchi, in the Ramsey theorem before, is that we want to have this witness for termination, and the witness for termination is showing that we are decreasing in one of the relations Ti. And this automaton does this directly. So it's looking, so each of the copies is for one of the relations Ti, and so the automaton can decide non-deterministically, taking this transition, that now I've seen an instance of this relation T2, so I go back to this initial state. So it's like just tracking descents in the relation T2, the bottom part of this. So basically, directly from the definition of this automaton, you get that if this automaton is universal, then the program terminates. Because you're always having a descent in one of the components. And so now, is this the most precise criterion? So the answer is yes, and I will have to argue why. But so first, I mention like that you have a, so first I give you an example where the one criterion does not apply and the other applies, but so for the interest of time, I have to skip the details, so you can find it in the paper. And then also to show that it's more general than the other criterion, we have this insight, so that the one criterion implies the other one. So if the automaton is universal itself, then also this our automaton is universal. And so this has a very short proof. But I'm also skipping it. But I just mentioning that the only fact you need for proving this is the fact from automata theory that an automaton is universal if and only if it accepts all ultimately periodic words. So this this is the fact which is replacing the application of Ramsey. And so then as a corollary, you get the original result, but without using Ramsey. So now I'm just sketching the results which are in the paper, and so then I will conclude. So I'm only able to motivate the results in the paper and give you an overview what is in the paper. So the main strategy for proving the results of the paper is that you can basically view this Bücher automaton, which we have just seen, as a size change system. So they are almost identical. And so because of this, you get that the termination criteria, which I presented for the size change abstraction, and this new termination criterion, that they agree. And so the size change system is also interesting. So the second bullet point is that because we can kind of view it as a canonical program for which the automaton is an abstraction. So this means, so the system we are extracting has precisely this information, or descends only in the variables which are really tracked by the automaton. So so it is the second, so this lets us transfer lower bounds. And then we have the other point, the third bullet point, is that every run of a program can be tracked by an automaton of this size chain system we extract, which has an almost similar domain. So these are the key technical results for relating these two things. And then so the results we obtain is, so the first one is the precision, that so if that if this factor automaton is not universal, so then there is indeed a program of which this automaton is abstraction, but the program does not terminate. So when you're focusing solely on the information captured by the automaton, then you cannot do better. So this is what the statement is saying. And the second statement is about automated complexity, about complexity analysis, so which you, the information you can extract from a termination proof, is that when we have a termination proof by some automaton A of a program gamma, and then I can now look at this canonic size change system associated to this automaton and use the previous result on the size change abstraction, and I get this exponent k. So then basically this k is also an upper bound, n to the k is an upper bound for the program for which you have a proof by a transition invariant. And again, this is the best you can do, because there's also this canonic size change system associated to this automaton for which it is the best complexity. Okay, so to conclude, so this was the question I started with. And so part of the question has been to define precisely what are inductive proofs with transition predicate abstraction. And so this is like this new notion of transition abstraction. And for this notion, transition abstraction, I have been able to transfer these results from the size change abstraction to this new abstraction. So what you can do with these results is basically, it means that you can look at Terminator 1.0, like which used transition invariants. The new one does not. But so this means you could try to look at all the proofs it computed and also extract complexity from them. So the theory in this paper would allow you to do that. Of course, more practical work is needed to examine how well this works. And then also, so the complexity analysis, of course, depends on the kind of transition or termination proof you computed. So you can experiment with different strategies for predicate generation. So, and this would have impact on the complexity you get in practice. Okay, thanks for your attention.
Questions?
You mentioned that you get kind of a new proof for the transition invariants without Ramsey theorem.
Yes.
And you also mentioned in the beginning this result by Blass and Gurevich about relating the ordinal height. Does this also lead to a new proof of that?
No. So like the result of Blass and Gurevich is also precise. Like you cannot do better. But so the proof objects they are looking at is just they are looking at. So they just assume that you have the assumption that the transitive height is contained in these relations. And so with this assumption, you cannot do better. So like the result I have is like when you have, in addition, an inductive proof why this transitive file is contained in these relations, then you can do better.
Thank you.
Okay, so also about this alternative proof. So it's always interesting to see a new proof, but your proof uses the existence of ultimately periodic words.
Yes.
And how do you prove the existence of ultimately periodic words?
So I have a footnote in the paper so to for that point. So like when you present it like to your students in a lecture, you're also using Ramsey because it's an easy proof of this fact, but you don't need to. Like so in order to prove this result, you just need to rely on properties of finite monoids. So, and like when you accumulate enough facts about finite monoids, you are also able to prove that statement. Yeah.
So in the handbook, the article by Wolfgang Thomas also uses an alternative proof. But I think the original one by Bucci uses the...
Yes, I think so as well, yeah.
Another method for proving termination is variant function. Can you derive the variant function from the automata?
So this is like very interesting to do. And so for like the size change abstraction, I had a partial result when the size change abstraction corresponds to deterministic automata. And so and then we were able to extract, or I was able to extract ranking functions, which also captured the complexity precisely. So you can take a size change termination proof and extract a ranking function out of it, even if the original proof was not by ranking functions. And like for the general case, we still don't know how to do it precisely. And but it should be possible, so it's just we don't know. And the interesting thing about this relation is that it should carry over. So you should also, when you have the general case for the size change abstraction, you also will be able to get ranking functions for termination proofs by transition invariants.
So let's thank Florian again.